Formal good afternoon. Namaskar to all of you. Invited guest speaker of the today afternoon session, Professor G. N. Shastri, Director of Northeast Institute of Science and Technology, the CSIR Institute at Jorhat. We are very happy to have you as the speaker in this area of artificial intelligence as a tool for drug discovery. This is very interesting area for you. We have learned several things from your the talk in several occasions. We are very happy that again to have you for the new audience, for the young the participants who are with us. So we are, there are several credentials to address Dr. G. N. Shastri over here, but still one of time I asked that our the colleague Dr. Somasundaram to acknowledge is the credential by extending few information, sharing a few information about Professor Shastri. We honestly welcome you on behalf of BOG and then our faculty and the students, participants from the other institute, other laboratory. So we are thankful for your acceptance being with us for delivering that talk, sir. Over to Dr. Somasundaram.
Good afternoon, sir, and good afternoon to all the participants. Welcome to the post lunch session of the today's event. I take privilege to introduce Professor Dr. G. N. Shastri, and he is a J.C. Bose National Fellow, and he was awarded with Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Chemical Sciences. He is considered as one of the highest prize for science and engineering in India. National Bioscience Award DBT in 2009, one of the highest for life sciences in India. Swarna Jayanti Fellowship, B.M. Birla Award, B.C. Deb Memorial Award, CRSI Medal, and AVH Fellowship. He has delivered more than 300 invited lectures, which includes talks in national and international conferences. He was a visiting professor at IMS Japan, LMU Munich, Germany, Jackson State University, USA, and Kyushu University, Japan. He was elected as a Fellow of National Academy of Sciences, Fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, Fellow of Association of Biotechnology and Pharmacy, Telangana State Academy of Sciences, and Andhra Pradesh Academy of Sciences. He has contributed major to the science in developing indigenous software for drug discovery, fundamental contributions to the concept of cooperatively of non-covalent interactions, and in the areas of buckyball chemistry. His current focus is on employing artificial intelligence and machine learning methods to integrate with cheminformatics, bioinformatics, and electronic structure calculations. I welcome you, sir, for your talk on drug discovery as a tool for artificial intelligence as a tool for drug discovery. Thank you, sir. Over to sir.
Thank you, Dr. Somasundaram, for your introduction. And at the outset, I would like to thank Professor Ravichandran and all the NIPER Calcutta fraternity, which I always feel it as my own home, and for giving me this opportunity to deliver this talk. Artificial intelligence is a term which is becoming increasingly unavoidable in whatever area that you are working in. However, drug discovery is a very specialized area in which artificial intelligence is of high relevance. And we would like to see in the next few days that how artificial intelligence will be helpful in drug discovery. I will try to give an overview about artificial intelligence or machine learning and deep learning a little bit, as well as a brief description about the challenges in drug discovery, drug development, as well as drug repurposing. So please consider that this particular talk is more of introducing terms and then introducing some of the challenges that are there in both machine learning, artificial intelligence, as well as in drug discovery. If you would like to look at the term intelligence in Oxford Dictionary, it's written like that. It is an ability to learn, understand, and think in a logical way about things, as well as the ability to do this well. That is called intelligence. When somebody displays a great skill to learn and a great skill to understand, we call that person as an intelligent person. How about artificial intelligence? For example, if I give a task to a person to allow somebody who is close to us in the home and don't allow somebody who is not close to us. So a particular individual will do this task. But can this be given to a machine? This is known traditionally as artificial intelligence. That is the study and development of computer systems that can copy intelligent human behavior. The biggest challenge that people have taken in artificial intelligence is games. Game theory was one of the very, very important areas in computer science where artificial intelligence play a very important role. And as many of us know, the great challenge of chess, which is considered as a very intelligent game, that when a machine can beat a grandmaster, this is something that is to be thought about. And there are also several games that if some of you, especially the younger generation people, when they are playing games on Android phone or a computer or wherever it is, they will see that there are so many logical steps that one has to take which require intelligence. Let us try to look at data, automation, and artificial intelligence. Actually, in the design of reactors in chemical engineering, in early 40s, people try to design reactors which will be most effective. The conversion will be very high, yields are very high, and the reactor design required to make many prototypes. What does it mean? If you want to design a reactor, you design a reactor and look at the efficiency. And if you want to improve, you change this reactor design to another prototype and then keep on optimizing the conditions so that you will come up with the most efficient machines. And so is the case for a motor car. If you want to have a motor car, if some of you are very much interested in Formula One racing, you know that this particular motor car should be very fast. For that, you have to optimize the weight. You have to also optimize the fuel that you put in, because you all know about pit stops that are there in the Formula One racing. So whether you take two pit stops or three pit stops, and how do you design, a lot of engineering goes in. And whatever may be the area of research, a large number of data which is available based on the known information can be used to design better and more optimal systems. This is so much true in nuclear reactors and optimizing their properties. So slowly in 50s, the term artificial intelligence is being popularized. Then there were quite a number of issues where people are trying to think that everything can be done with artificial intelligence and intelligent machines. Robotics play a very important role. And there were also some movies which have come about how you employ the artificial intelligence. But slowly, there is some enthusiasm and great expectations that were in 50s, late 50s and 60s. And this led to the application of artificial intelligence in a large number of other areas. Then we have knowledge-based systems. We have data. The data will be converted into information. That information can also be converted into knowledge. and there are systems which are knowledgeable systems. From there you can mine the information which is useful, and you can mine the relevant data. So the databases, knowledge bases, and collation of the data and information has picked up very, very aggressively in 60s and 70s. So in 80s, people are having access to a number of computer systems which are very, very effective. And also, people are coming up with very, very powerful algorithms. These algorithms are based on neural networks, evolutionary computing like genetic algorithms, fuzzy logic, random forest, support vector machines, and a large number of methods are being developed, starting from a simple fuzzy logic and decision trees. And 1986 onwards, the artificial intelligence has become a very, very important discipline, not only in computer science, but also in the allied areas. And late 90s have seen the emergence of intelligent agents and intelligent systems. And we have more and more data that is coming up. And now we are in the era of big data. What does it mean? We have a high volume of data which is so difficult for human beings to comprehend and analyze. So it becomes imperative that you use computer methods to understand what is this, what all this data means, and what do you do about it. So this is the volume. The velocity of the data acquisition, the rate at which data is generated, is also very high. The variety of the data is also very, very high, different types of data. Variability of data is also very high, and value of data is also very, very high. So there are a number of challenges and opportunities in the era of big data, and artificial intelligence, machine learning, data mining techniques have played a very important role. There are various techniques. Data is available in various forms. Data is available in terms of text. Data will be available in terms of voice. Data will be available in terms of images. So people try to get into different ways of understanding what does this data mean. And several things like machine learning, speech processing, image recognition, vision. This led to natural language processing, expert systems. You will have classification, planning, optimization, prediction, and ultimately robotics play a very important role. Text to speech and speech to text have made so many wonders in the last few years, and image processing and computer vision is also playing a very important role, and converting the sentences from one language to another have played a very, very important role. And all of this has become absolutely unavoidable in recent years. So let us look at learning in a simple way. What does it mean? What do you mean by learning? It's acquiring some knowledge, right? If you learn, you will learn something new. Learning happens when you observe a phenomena and recognize a pattern. So there are different types of things like unconscious incompetence or conscious incompetence, conscious competence, and unconscious competence. If you don't know what you don't know, that is unconscious incompetence. If you know what you don't know, that is conscious incompetence. You know that you don't know this, so you are aware of that. So conscious incompetence is much better than unconscious incompetence, because somebody does not even know what they don't know. What is unconscious competence? What you know is so it is that you know it, but you, it's not a primary knowledge that you have. It is like mugging or by hearting. So what is conscious competence? This is about, you know what you know. This is, you know, you are conscious about it, you are competent about what is going on, and there are different ways of learning. So is it possible for a machine to mimic the process of human learning? This is a big challenge. Can we replace a human being with a machine? Probably not. But if a human being can perform a large number of tasks, several of them can be replaced by a machine. Machine learning is nothing but this ability to learn is systematized, is subjected to a logic, an algorithm, a mathematical process. So this is a statistical or a mathematical or a computational technique that enables a machine to improve at the tasks with training. So whether it's human learning or machine learning, both involve observations and executing about a thing or a process or a phenomena, whatever it is. It may be involving images, it may be involving voice, it may be involving text, it may be involving numbers, so on and so forth. So now we can keep on talking about learning, machine learning, AI, but our focus is on drug discovery. So let us see, let us try to get back to drug discovery very soon. And the artificial intelligence will be helpful in aggregating and synthesizing information. It is also helpful in understanding the disease mechanisms and disease pathophysiology. It is also helpful in generating novel drug candidates using different methods. So it will be helpful in collating information in multidimensional platforms and mine data and analysis of genome or metabolic pathways or for understanding the disease and identify disease, genes and proteins involved in regulating the cell cycle and various pathways. And also it will be helpful in the generation of novel drug candidates. So let us look at drug discovery in a very simple way. That is, we always feel that there is a target which can be targeted for a disease. So target identification is important. So there are newer methods which are very close to the heart of your director, Professor Ravichandran, like polypharmacology and network pharmacology, where there may be multiple targets for a disease, or a particular target can be used for multiple diseases. So these are the new knowledges that are coming out, but the very, very primitive model, because we always need to have a very simple model to improve upon. A simple model is, there is a disease has several targets, and a small molecule will bind or do something with that target to elicit biological response, right? So you have to have a target identification, and one has to validate the target and develop an assay and somehow get a hit and develop that hit into lead and optimize the lead. And once the lead is optimized, you go to the preclinical phase, and afterwards you go to clinical phase. So up to preclinical phase, it is called drug discovery process. And when you go to clinical phase, this is called drug development process. And drug discovery and drug development are very, very important areas which involve lots of stakes. And I'm sorry, next slide is coming in between for machine learning. I will try to skip this. like you have in machine learning, you have supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. This is a very important slide for you to understand what are the different methods that are there and what is the difference between them. So the types of artificial intelligence are sequence of making machines to do things requiring human intelligence, and takes AI a step further with computer algorithms to learn and improve. And deep learning is next generation machine learning with multiple layers of learning from massive data. So there are different applications of AI in drug discovery, machine learning to remotely monitor patient. This is not exactly drug discovery, but this is in a broader area of healthcare. So AI to predict untested components, AI to find treatments for rare diseases. This is very, very important because rare diseases and rare metabolic disorders are very important areas wherein it may not be commercially profitable. Why it is not commercially profitable? Obviously, a rare disease is a concern for very, very small number of population people who are affected, in contrast to a disease which is very popular like diabetes or hypertension or cancer. So one can use the computational methods to come up with effective ways of treating these rare diseases. IBM Watson, which is a very important tool, which had a lot of fame in recent years, match patients with right trials through artificial intelligence. And there are different ways of AI to help patients with cancer diagnostics with AstraZeneca or iCure and AbbVie, which will talk about image recognition to improve drug adherence, and artificial intelligence to predict effect of new treatments, artificial intelligence to proactively find drug candidates. There are a number of ways in which machine learning, data mining, and artificial intelligence will be helpful in drug discovery and drug repurposing. I just wanted to tell you, conventionally, drug discovery require a number of aspects to deal with. The molecule has to be novel, intellectual property also has to be seen, and structural activity, pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, in vivo data, safety. This required people with varied experience. Like, for example, pharmacology is very, very important. In addition, biochemistry, enzymology, synthetic chemistry, physical chemistry, combinatorial chemistry, metabolism, safety assessment. Pathology is also important. Information technology is important. Patent laws are important. So inherently, drug discovery is a very, very interdisciplinary subject. So we will have to see. Hello. Shifting. I think we have to understand that data science is unavoidable, and this is also known as fourth paradigm. So you get a lot of data. Building a heterogeneous database having volume, variety, velocity, variability, veracity, and value, as we have discussed about the V's of big data, this is so much of relevance and importance in drug discovery, because a large number of experiments are being performed, and this data, whether this data is yielding you the results that you desire or not, will give you a lot of scope for our understanding and for our knowledge. And you also have different types of simulations, different types of structural properties, different types of analysis, and the scientific literature that is there. All of that will be available, and data extraction and pre-processing is very important, and data reduction and selection, modeling and mining correlations, and evaluation and feedback. These are different steps. For example, how much data, what kind of data, what are the features that are identified, and how do you extract the features? This is very important even when you have an unsupervised data set. Then, if you have a data set, if there are parameters which depend on each other, if you can have some sort of techniques to reduce the dimensionality, that will be very good. So the dimensionality reduction with the PCA or any other analysis will be of great relevance. Then you have modeling and mining correlations, which you can use classification, clustering, optimization, various techniques, and neural networks and other algorithms of machine learning will be very useful. And evaluation and feedback is very important. Training and testing split various ways in which you can get the evaluation of this data, where this data will give you what is known as knowledge. And I just wanted to take you that this particular transformation that is there is not restricted to drug discovery. It is there in every single approach that one takes, whether it is a machine or a computer or a car or even fashion design. Artificial intelligence is so much used in leather industry for the footwear design. I was amazed when I was going through the footwear design for the diabetic foot, for the customized foot, and the number of parameters that are there are so high, and people are using very sophisticated algorithms based on artificial intelligence to come up with these types of designs. So, as I said, you have various stages in drug discovery, and there the target validation, high throughput screening, hit to lead and lead optimization, preclinical development. Up to preclinical development, it may take 4 years of that order, and clinical development may take about 6 to 8 years. So with the data driven models, we will be able to save 1 or 2 years in this approach. So I just wanted to quickly go through the drug development cycle, because this will be of some importance to the people. So when you get a molecule at a preclinical stage, you will get a stage wherein you apply for investigational new drug applications, IND, where the clinical steps will start. And before you go to that stage, safety assessment, pharmacology, pharmaceutical R&D development, and all the data, statistics and epidemiology, data coordination, these things are collected, where you will be going for IND, and then clinical trials will start. That procedure is known as drug development. And up to this, all the from drug discovery, target identification, and getting all the data and animal experimentations and everything, this is called preclinical. In the clinical trials, where you get IND, you have a phase one clinical trials where you try to use the drug on some healthy volunteers. A few dozens of healthy volunteers were taken, where one will test the absorption and metabolism, effects of on organs and tissues, and side effects as dosage is increased. So essentially, on healthy volunteers, a drug that is developed should not have any negative effect. For that, we need to have an ethical clearance for people to enroll as volunteers, and then they have to be paid. And also, we have to make sure that any drug should not have a bad side effect on a healthy patient. That's a requirement. So in phase one clinical trial, there is no mention about the disease. only in phase 2 clinical trials, you have a treatment group and a control group, and one takes a larger number of health impaired patients, and there will also be a control group where the effectiveness of the drug, the efficacy is tested. And also in this phase 2, the short-term side effects in health impaired patients are also seen. So in the phase 1, the side effects with the healthy patients, in side 2, the health impaired patients will also be seen. And many times there will be different types of cohort groups which are created, and these cohort groups will have their own conditions and sizes based on the requirement. Then one goes to phase 3 clinical trials, which is by far the most critical phase, where a number of candidates will fail because hundreds of thousands of health impaired patients are tested upon, and it is how the benefit risk relationship of a drug is there will be assessed. Because every drug will have some side effects, there will be a risk, but what is the ratio between benefit and risk? If it is more beneficial than risky, then it's good, right? And one will also be looking at longer term side effects. So phase three clinical trials will always be taking much longer than this. And also in phase 3 clinical trials, one will be adjusting the dosage for different types of populations. Then there will be a compassionate use. So this particular process where the drug development is there is going through phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and then afterwards there will be a new drug application, and NDA is cleared, and after this NDA, still people will have to sell the drug and make some profit, but there will be a post-market surveillance that is called phase 4, wherein even if at that stage, if a particular drug develops some side effects, this particular drug will be withdrawn. So what are the challenges that are there in drug discovery and development? The challenges are, what are the delivery routes? Sometimes a particular drug is effective, but it is oral or other alternative delivery routes. That's very, very important to find out. And what are the drug-drug interactions? For example, a particular patient is having already a disease, and when they're taking a drug, what are the drug-drug interactions that are existing? What are the differentiation from the current therapies? For example, there are some existing therapies that are there, and how this particular new drug will be different? What is the safety? What is the cost? What is the efficacy of this particular therapy? And most importantly, how do you optimize the dosing frequency? And definitely cost of the drug. And what is the risk? And sometimes what is the misuse of the drug? And what are the tolerable side effects? Whether it's tolerable or not tolerable. And sometimes it's very important to assess the safety in some special people like pregnant women or breastfeeding population. And what are the dosage adjustments in pediatric patients? That's also very important. And monitoring is also very important. And especially the renal issues and other issues play a very important role. So usually drug discovery is a process wherein you will have research and development, and the product launch will take almost 10 to 12 years. Afterwards, still one has to spend money to come out, and for a particular drug to be commercially successful, the amount of money that you in your y-axis, you have this expected value where you have to invest a lot of money. And most of the cases, all these attempts will be buried, and this is known as valley of death. It is very, very rare that a particular compound will cross this valley and then come as a successful business model. But once it comes as a successful business model, it will definitely yield lots of benefits to the company. But one has to realize that it's very difficult for companies to go through all these losses for many companies. That's the reason why drug discovery has become a particular monopoly of some of the very, very big giants, wherein they will try to buy the intellectual property right at different levels. So this is very important. So there are several artificial intelligence startups that are there, and many of them you may be knowing. There are several startups that are there, and then it's continue to increase. And I have this data about 5-6 months before, but during this COVID, the number of startups are increasing in a very, very big way. And I hope that India has a unique position wherein some enthusiastic people, the younger population in the audience, should be able to take up the startups as a very challenging issue. And there are many opportunities that are there with several government as well as non-government initiatives in the startup. So artificial intelligence in drug discovery and development can be used in a number of areas, like in preclinical development, lead discovery, or biomarker discovery, or in target identification or validation, or pharmacovigilance, which is a very, very important area. I don't have to stress the importance of pharmacovigilance for the NIPAR students, and data mining, ontology building, and chemical synthesis, and finding materials and consumables, virtual lab assistants, and virtual lab assistants and virtual doctors. Artificial intelligence and drug discovery and development is very important. But I feel that the most important area is drug repurposing. Drug repurposing is one area wherein there is a lot of scope for artificial intelligence and molecular modeling techniques to play an important role. What is drug repurposing? It is a process of finding new uses outside the scope of the original medical indication for existing drugs. It is also known as redirecting, repurposing, repositioning, reprofiling. And it is realized long before, but only recently, the importance of this drug repurposing is highlighted, because there are a large number of drugs which will be very effective for other diseases. And the most important area here is, for a particular disease, a drug should be used in some concentration. For another disease, it may have to be used in a different concentration. So this will be very, very effective in different types of diseases, and it is a very hot area. What is the advantage? The advantage is comparison of drug repurposing and NCEs, novel drug candidates. Drug repurposing will take a fraction of time and cost compared to NCE, right? The success rate is also very, very high. The success rate of a typical NCE is 1 in 10,000 after getting the mass hits. And in the case of drug repurposing, the success rate is very, very high, because if you have a particular drug which got the FDA clearance for a number of reasons, if it shows efficacy in some other disease, it is very likely that it will be successful. A repositioned drug does not need the initial years typically required for the discovery of new drugs. This is the key, but instead goes directly to preclinical testing and clinical trials, that thus reducing risk and cost. It doesn't stop here. In the clinical trials, it avoids a large number of routes. And usually for the clinical trials of a repositioning, it will take only 6 months to 1 year in some cases. Whereas for a completely new candidate, safety tests are all much more stringent, because a lot of data is already available for a drug which is already having the regulatory approval. So this is very, very important. And I would like to take the next few minutes to talk about a particular software that we are developing in our group. This is known as a molecular property diagnostic suite. Is being developed with the purpose of strengthening computational drug discovery in the country. And we wanted to have a particular software which will have the ability to perform all the chemoinformatics, molecular modeling, structure-based and analog-based approaches, and molecular dynamic simulations for drug discovery. And the idea is you have a large number of different techniques that are necessary to employ in drug discovery. And we would like to have a platform which will integrate all these efforts. And this particular platform will be specific to a particular disease, right? So this is called developing a disease-specific web portal. So these disease-specific web portals are being developed in our group. And here, a lot of data mining, artificial intelligence, and machine learning applications are required. So there are different modules. In this MPDS, there are disease-specific target information, metabolic pathway information, FDA approval drug information, disease-specific crystal structure database, and we also have a chemical space, which is now around 130 million compounds, which were curated from 37 different databases. And there are some disease independent modules like descriptor calculations, file format conversion, all the technical things like 3D structure conversion, and then developing QSAR equations, docking, and protein ligand interactions and visualization tools. And in addition to that, we also have some advanced tools based on the machine learning and hybrid QMMM calculations. So this open source drug discovery hosted at CSIR NIST now, earlier it was in IICT Hyderabad, and it is on a Galaxy server, and it has the indigenously developed scripts where open source drug discovery tools for molecular docking, virtual screening, QSAR, Drulito, pass analysis and parallel descriptors are generated, and we have different platforms for each disease, and many of them share the common modules, but some of them are unique to a particular disease. So we are also trying to look at the exhaustive way of generating chemical and biological space. As most of you know, chemistry is always associated with diversity, and biology is associated with complexity. So chemical biology, or understanding chemistry and biology, require a way of comprehending both diversity and complexity. And we are in need of employing a number of machine learning AI tools, and that's being done in our group currently. So we actually wanted to represent the molecule. There are different ways in which you can represent a molecule, and these representations can be in the form of three-dimensional structure or a two-dimensional structure in terms of a molecular formula, or in terms of a particular string, alphanumerical string, which is known as in the form of a Smiles notation or Inchi key, which have alpha numerical strings. But the language that a computer understands at the basic level is the Boolean logic, ones and zeros. So one developed the chemical fingerprints, which we have developed for structural classification, and we wanted to employ different machine learning tools to divide the chemical space into different areas. And for example, for drugs, catalysts, pesticides, metabolites, and toxins. And this particular molecule which is available in a database will have a unique ID, which I call it as an Aadhaar card. And this particular concept of generating an Aadhaar card for every molecule that is there is being pursued, and then hopefully this will be emerging as a very, very important concept. As we have said, this MPDS chemical space and biological space, we have currently 130 million compounds, and the biological space is a lot more complex than what we are thinking. And then we are now trying to give Aadhaar card for the biological space also. And the MPDS server will have the mutation analysis, also have the protein stability and evolutionary relationships for drug design and repurposing and structure function relationships. And it employs text mining, AI, machine learning, and other data driven approaches. In addition to that, MPDS will also have some modules which are very general about immunity, inflammation, and the general health parameters which can be monitored. So we have this MPDS, and tuberculosis, diabetes, and metabolic disorders, and HIV and COVID are also almost ready. Some of them are published and some of them are under preparation. And then we are very much looking forward to propagate this in the next couple of years, where we will have a very decent version to share with every one of you. Now also they are available. I just wanted to tell you that science is but a perversion of itself, unless it has as its ultimate goal is the betterment of humanity. This is what is done by, this is what is mentioned by Nikola Tesla, which I have a great regard. And those of you who go through the life of Nikola Tesla, who is a contemporary of the great Thomas Alva Edison. And I'm very much convinced that Tesla's contributions are at least as important or as fundamental as Edison's and other contributions. So after taking over the CSIR NIST as a director about close to 2 years before, I was very much excited to see what are the possibilities that we can do to use this knowledge for the betterment of the region. And as many of you know, that this particular region of Northeast is not very far from West Bengal and Kolkata. So we are almost neighbors, and this Northeast consists of 8 different states, and CSIR NIST is the only CSIR laboratory for the entire 8 states. So we represent all the 8 states, although it is formally in Assam. So there are different research areas like advanced computation and data science, and we have chemistry, biology, geoscience, and other areas. So how much time I have, Dr. Somasundaram?
15 minutes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. So when the COVID pandemic struck us, we have started from the scratch and then made a COVID testing laboratory. Within 2 months, we are able to complete it. And so far, we are able to complete around 38,000 tests. This is a number which is not updated. Now we have a huge capacity, but the number of requests are coming down. That's why we are not going aggressively for testing. Actually, last 1 week, we have stopped because the number of samples are less. And we also are doing the serological testing and the sero study, which is a part of the Phenome India project. And we have tested more than 1,000 patients. So in East Jorhat, where we don't have any idea about biomedical testing, we are able to launch this within 2 months by investing close to 8 to 10 crores, and everything has started from the scratch. And this shows that when there is a crisis, there is also an opportunity. Without this, we would not have ever gone into COVID testing. Similarly, the summer research training program that is offered by the three academies of India, Indian Academy of Sciences in Bangalore, Indian National Science Academy in Delhi, and National Academy of Sciences in Allahabad, they were giving online research training, summer research training for about 2,000 people. But in 2020, they could not give for more than 160 people. So at that time, again, we have taken up this activity, and within a week of our announcement, 16,000 people have applied. And then we have taken all these people and then provided the training with the help of our sister laboratories. But CSIR NIST has given training for over 10,000 of these people because we have taken the initiative. This involves eminent scientist lectures, research projects, and there is lecture series, and there are many, many other activities in association with Royal Society and Individ India Alliance we have done. And the participation is across the country. The blue marks from Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, and Uttar Pradesh are over 15,000 people have participated from these states. And as you can see, every single state is represented, and we have lectures by very eminent people like our DGCSIR and DST Secretary, DPT Secretary. In addition to that, we have also Sri N.R. Narayan Murthy, founder of Infosys, R.A. Mashelkar, and the PSA, Prime Minister Scientific Advisor, Dr. Vijay Raghavan, who gave a talk along with many, many other people. And I also would like to bring to your notice that we have conducted drug discovery hackathon in several of the speakers who are lined up here has given talks in our drug discovery hackathon program, which was held between 13th July 2020 to 11th September 2020, wherein we focused three different verticals. The vertical one is focused on the theory and computational methods. The vertical two is focused on algorithms and method development. And vertical three has hands-on sessions on open source and commercial softwares. And I am very, very happy to tell you that all these lectures are available on our YouTube channel. And if any of you are interested, I would be recommending every one of you to go through these YouTube channels and see that whether these lectures will be of any use to you. And the Advanced Computation and Data Science Division in CSIR NIST has different activities. As I told, the development of indigenous software for drug discovery and disease-specific web portals, MPDS, is one important area. And we are also trying to use artificial intelligence and machine learning in diverse areas like agriculture, food, nutrition, biodiversity. And we are also focusing on human resource development. If some of you are interested to do PhD or advanced training in artificial intelligence and machine learning, they can always approach us. And we are also trying to get the bioinformatics infrastructure facilities. And we also have an idea to collaborate with doctors to work in this area. And we always feel that if you identify what are the challenges, it is easy to solve these challenges. So a question which is very well posed is half solved. So similarly, for example, some challenges that we have in Assam, like pest control in tea cultivation, it's a huge challenge. There's insufficient crop productivity. That's also a big challenge for various reasons. Although land is fertile and we have a lot of water, storage of agricultural produce is another challenge. And crude oil contamination is another challenge. So we feel that AI and machine learning techniques will be greatly helpful in coming up with scientific strategies in solving these problems. Similarly, we have taken different states in Northeast. For example, in Manipur, the poor connectivity to mainland, there are not much connectivity to Imphal and other places, and poor quality of sand and gravel for construction purpose. And how do we deal with this? And like that, you can take any state. Nagaland, for example, have inadequate post-harvesting facilities and processing and marketing of cash crops, honey and meat product is a challenge. And similarly, in Arunachal, sustainable harnessing of medicinal plants and orchids and remote from the mainland. I would like to tell you that harnessing of the rare medicinal plants is of very high importance for healthcare as well as drug discovery. And states like Northeastern states, all of them play a very, very important role in this. And I feel that Arunachal will be a hub along with other states. And there are several opportunities, whether it is agriculture or mining and minerals or water management or disaster management or hazard management, petroleum industry, and how do you convert the traditional knowledge and practices into something of utility, like, for example, the culture, languages, organic farming, traditional food, handlooms and handicrafts, and most importantly, the ethnomedicine. Ethnopharmacology and ethnomedicine are very, very important for us to harness the knowledge that is there for several hundreds of thousands of years with people. And this has to be validated scientifically, and it has to be integrated with the practices that we have for healthcare. So I just wanted to tell you that the data that is there will be huge. When the data that is there that is huge, there is a lot of scope for accelerating drug discovery with AI solutions. AI will help you to go from one area to another area very, very easily. And there is a scope for improving access to robust and reliable data and recognize the disruptive potential of technical giants and increasing diversification of drug discovery pipeline and acquiring new AI skills and talents are very important. And establishing new key performance indicators is also very important. And I just wanted to say that in every area, whether it is drug discovery, trials or approval, AI has a huge role to play in the coming years. And this will continue like this. And I was thinking of showing some of the success stories of AI, and these success stories are too many. So I just wanted to tell you that it's one of the very, very highly spreading subject. The penetration of artificial intelligence in drug discovery is very high. And now I would like you to expose to one of the most important areas, that is personalized medicine. Personalized medicine, that is to understand that different people have different ways of reacting to the same drug. And it's important to customize a drug for different individuals. That is 4P, somebody will also talk about 5P. Most important P is personalized, predictive, preventive, participatory medicines are important. So this requires to deal with a huge amount of data, and artificial intelligence and machine learning play a very important role. So there are a number of tools which are based on AI for drug discovery. And I hope that in the next couple of days, several people will be touching upon them. And as very active members in this particular century, people should explore on their own. And there is a huge potential for developing new knowledge from the data that is there with the help of AI and machine learning. I would like to thank you very much for your kind and patient hearing. And all of this is possible because of the involvement of a large number of students. And this is not my group. This is a photograph taken where we have a recent workshop on bioinformatics. So I thank once again Professor Ravichandran and all the faculty members of Calcutta and participants for patiently hearing me, and I will be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you very much, sir, for this informative, wonderful and interesting lecture. It is really beneficial to us as well as our audience which participate across the country. So I would like to summarize your talk. You have started discussing what is the importance of drug discovery, what are the different steps of drug development, and how the drug repurposing is very important. You started explaining artificial intelligence in the layman language. And then you discussed what is the data, how day by day the size is increasing, the form of volume or variety or various form, it may be text or image. Then you explain different process of drug discovery, like drug identification, drug validation, target validation, hit identification, and from preclinical stage to the clinical, how much time is consumed. Then you also elaborated different kind of methods, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, and you have given an example like different company, IBM, Watson, they have their own tool, AstraZeneca also have. And you also discussed the data science as a fourth paradigm. As we in the 21st century, we did data engineering, whether in the form biological form as well as chemical form. So in the data science, data extraction, data reduction, and modeling, evaluation, and feedback is very important. So then you discuss the different phase of the clinical trial, phase first, second, third, and fourth. And you discuss how time is invested, money is invested in each and every form. So then you indicate the importance of AI in different fields like preclinical form, lead discovery, biomarker field, data mining field, chemical synthesis, so many on. And especially you have emphasis on drug repurposing versus the new chemical entities. So indicator how if we go for the drug repurposing, it can reduce the time invested for new application as well as the cost. Even clinical trial period also drive a huge amount. You also discuss your tool on molecular property diagnostic suite, MPDS, and also discuss different modules like disease independent as well as disease independent module. And you have also elaborated that this is compiling data for different fields like TB, HIV, COVID, so on. You also discuss the automation of biological as well as chemical space, as well how to classify different kind of data like whether they are drug related, catalyst, pesticide, metabolites, and toxin. Then you discuss the different what you have been doing in this last COVID period, testing, training, and drug discovery hackathon. And finally, you touch the personal medicine, importance of AI in the personal medicine. Thank you, sir, for this wonderful lecture. So I would like the audience